Chairman of Nirma Education and Research Foundation, respected Dr. Karsanbhai Patel, Executive Chairman Dr. Vasani, Director of the Institute Professor Singh, Dr. Trivedi, Director, Institute of Technology, members of the Governing Council and faculties, joyous parents, friends, students, the citizens of tomorrow, filled with ideas, and I'm sure ideals, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen. I deem it a great honor that I have been asked, invited to deliver the first convocation address of Nirma University, the year 2006. Nirma University has made a distinct mark in the world of education under the guidance and visionary leadership of Karsanbhai. Nirma has attained excellence and occupies a pride of place amongst educational institutions, and I'm very proud to be here. I've been here only half an hour, in the sense that when I came, I went around, saw a bit of the library, saw a bit of the auditorium. But what attracted me most was the atmosphere of the place. The sense of peace and tranquility that pervaded here. And I requested Karsanbhai and others that when I am very harassed in Delhi with lawyers and judges, I'll make a quick exit, come to Nirma under a pseudonym. Because if anyone knows Shri Soli J Sorabjee is here, they'll make me here also. At present, there is a plethora of degrees and diplomas which are awarded for various courses. The criteria for awarding a degree, acquiring a degree, is the student's proficiency and ability in a particular field or discipline in which he or she is engaged. That is usually judged by the percentage of marks obtained in the written examination and also in viva voce tests. Now today I am not going to discuss anything about the merits or demerits of the system. Today what I wish to stress is the conspicuous absence of a course in good citizenship and lack of emphasis on ethical values and principles in whatever activity one is engaged or one may be pursuing. Sir, I firmly believe that the objective of any educational institution should be not merely to turn out students who will be competent engineers or business managers or doctors or lawyers or other professionals. The success of an educational institution should be judged not by the number of trained and skillful professionals and technocrats it has produced, but on how many of them have been good citizens, developed a social conscience, and have rendered service to the neglected segments of Indian humanity in whatever field or discipline they may be engaged in. I think it's a cruel paradox of our times that an age that has witnessed tremendous scientific progress and technological development has at the same time also experienced an unprecedented decline, or rather a catastrophic decline in moral and spiritual values. Advances in technology and science have not generated equity nor guaranteed human dignity. The root cause of this catastrophic decline in moral and ethical values is that we have thrown God out of the window without any adequate and fulfilling replacement. We are worshipping false gods, and our most constant and fervent worship is reserved for Mammon, the omnipresent and omnipotent God of wealth. relentless pursuit of fame and fortune has become the universal religion. Acquisition of power and position are considered indispensable for success in life, and that is equated with making quick and easy fortunes without scruples about the means employed. Today we judge a person not by what he is, not by his character, but what he possesses. The poet William Wordsworth in 1802 lamented, and he said, "Today the wealthiest man among us is the best. Plain living and high thinking are no more." I think the situation which he lamented in 1802 is the same in 2006 also in our country. We have forgotten Einstein's wholesome advice, I quote, "Try not to be a man of success, but rather try to become a man of value." I think the trouble is we have been overtaken by the demon of materialism and obsessed with owning things and showing them off to the world. "Kaun Banega Crorepati" became a very popular program precisely because of spur and stimulus for becoming rich quickly. I told Amitabh Bachchan, "Why not say Kaun Karega Desh Ki Seva? Kaun Banega Desh Ka Neta?" Why this all the time emphasis on success and material wealth? The other problem is, sir, that we have become cynical. And today we have reached a stage where we know the price of everything and the value of nothing. My first advice to you, dear students, is that you should never yield to cynicism or fatalism, the belief that things have become so terribly wrong that no improvement is possible. Fatalism is a grand alibi for shirking responsibilities and justifying our lethargy, which is the antithesis of progress. And when I say cynical and lethargy, I have in mind the evil of corruption, the menace of corruption, the cancer of corruption. Don't ever get into the belief that nahi nahi ye to thavano chhe, you can't help it, it's an accepted view of life, you have to be corrupt. We want a corruption-free society, and for that there cannot be any fatalistic belief that we can't change this. We can change this. If we mean to do it, we can. But the agonizing question is, how do we cope with these developments? What measures should be adopted to arrest this calamitous fall in values? In this endeavor, the role of education is extremely important. Herbert Spencer believed that the function of education is to prepare us for complete living. In 1954, the US Supreme Court in its celebrated decision in Brown versus Board of Education outlawed segregation education institutions. Blacks were not admitted to education institutions by this historic decision that was outlawed, declared unconstitutional. Chief Justice Warren, who delivered the unanimous judgment of the court, observed, and I'd like to quote, "Education is the very foundation of good citizenship. Today it is a principal instrument in awakening the child to cultural values, in preparing him for later professional training, and helping him to adjust normally to his environment." Quotes over. I think it is almost universally accepted that education comprises not the narrow conception of instruction, but embraces all forms of human experience, because every stimulus with its corresponding reaction has a definite effect on character. It may be either aesthetic, ethical, intellectual or physical, but to be most satisfactory it must involve and develop all these sides of human capability. The mind, the heart, the hands of young students, must be engaged in forming their own character to know what is good, to love good, and to do good. We should inculcate in the hearts and minds of the young values which do not make them hanker after fame and fortune, after wealth and power. Instill in them the spirit of public service and sacrifice. Teach them to shun ill-gotten wealth and take pride in the modest fruits of honest working and living. Sir, I firmly believe that our hope lies with young students, with the youth, on whom the prison gates of materialism have not yet closed, and who still retain some idealism and belief in the values of honesty and decency. Our endeavor must be to bring about a qualitative change in the thinking of the people, especially the youth, in their attitude to life and their priorities. Mind you, wealth and material advantages it brings need not be condemned or spurned, but the fatal fascination for wealth and power must be abjured. There are other pujas apart from Lakshmi Puja. If you devote yourself only to Lakshmi Puja, then I'm afraid things are not going to improve, they'll get worse. Making a fortune by honest means, especially by business houses, which respect ethical norms and principles in the conduct of their business, is a matter for admiration and should not occasion envy or resentment in fair-minded people. I want to say a few words about business houses and ethics, as many of you are potential captains of industry and heads of big business houses. Now, it cannot be disputed that the business community is a very important segment in any democratic society based on market economy. Consequently, business enterprises, by very reason of their activities and public functions, functions which affect the community, have certain obligations, certain implicit obligations which have an intrinsic ethical or moral element. Regrettably, the common thinking of the world of trade and commerce is that ethical considerations and social responsibilities are irrelevant. What's a bakwasa? When I talk to them and some people come, class, consult me and I say, well, this is not done, this is not correct. No, sir, it's okay. I'm going to tell you. It's a bakwasa, not do moral and ethical. It's an unfortunate part. Of course, I have no time for such class and I say, okay. What is relevant is demand
and supply and market forces in a competitive system.
The main motivation and the prevalent temper of the times are for accumulation of wealth and power and influence without the slightest regard about the means employed. By and large, apart from honorable exceptions, there is no acceptance of social responsibilities and moral obligations. A majority of business persons have been brainwashed, or rather they have brainwashed themselves into the religious belief that because of the existing proliferation of laws and the widespread prevalence of corruption at all levels, it is not possible, or rather not profitable, in carrying on trade or business to comply with the applicable laws and regulations. Therefore, the notion of discharging social responsibilities and conforming to ethical norms appears to them something quixotic, something really fanciful, something unrealistic and meaningless. Now, this is totally unacceptable. It must not be forgotten that lack of commercial morality contributes substantially to maladministration. It encourages corruption and is antithetical to good governance. It is, however, refreshing to learn that enlightened business houses are moving away from the assumption that the sole purpose of business is to make profits. It is now being gradually realized that business enterprises must also improve the health of the society in which they operate, by strictly complying, for example, with environmental laws. They also should be alive to their human rights obligations to their staff, to the labor, to other members of the community. Profits are important to the survival of the enterprise,
but must not override the needs of all the stakeholders, which include shareholders, employees, customers, suppliers, communities, our planet, and the heirs to the planet. Increasingly, and that's a good sign, business leaders and managers are slowly coming around to the view that socially responsible practices enhance long-term profitability and competitiveness. Nirma University has an important part to play in fostering the awareness, this awareness, encouraging sound ethical practices and to produce enlightened corporate citizens. Friends, in the ultimate analysis, if you reflect, the one commodity of which we are badly in short supply is character. My mind goes back to the concluding remarks of Dr. Rajendra Prasad, concluding remarks from the 25th of November in the Constituent Assembly debates, when he said, and I quote, "India needs today nothing more than a set of honest men who will have the interests of the country before them." Please tell me how many you can count on your fingers afterwards. If the people who are elected are capable and men of character and integrity, they will be able to make the best even of a defective constitution. If they are lacking in these, the constitution cannot help the country. The ring and resonance of those words, the insistence on persons of character and integrity, I think have a compelling relevance today. You see, we have banished the ideas of truth, honesty and decency and regard them as the silly slogans of impractical people. Today we are paying a heavy price for that banishment. Now our endeavor must be to allow re-entry into our lives, especially into our public lives and into the world of trade and commerce, of these ideals and values. It is a stupendous task, but the stakes too are stupendous. The functioning, or possibly the survival of a stable and vibrant democracy, which is a basic feature of our constitution. See, on account of indiscriminate, or rather promiscuous use, if I may say, of democracy, of the word democracy, we tend to forget that democracy is a difficult and complicated enterprise. It is not the simplicity of a dictatorship. Democracy in any sphere is a serious undertaking. And let me read to you the words of the great American jurist Louis Brandeis, who said, and I quote, "Democracy substitutes self-restraint for external restraint. It is more difficult to maintain than to achieve. It demands continuous sacrifice by the individual and more exigent obedience to the moral law than any other form of government. Success in any democratic undertaking must proceed from the individual. It is possible only with the process of perfecting the individual is pursued." Quotation over. That is the reason why no office in the country is more important than that of a citizen, and no duties are more compelling than those to be performed by citizens who are, after all, are the ultimate sovereign in a democracy. Those in charge of and at the head of Nirma University have a special role and responsibility to play in this matter. But I have no doubt that they will unfailingly and gloriously lead the way and inspire others to emulate their example. And I wish all the students who have graduated today, I wish you all the best of luck in your future endeavors, in your future activities. And I hope you'll also be successful not only in the profession or particular line of business that you may adopt, but you'll also be successful in the art of living, living fully, constructively, and selflessly. On you depends, my dear young students, the future of our country, and may you make Nirma proud, Gujarat proud, India proud, And may others follow your example and say, oh, he's a Nirma person. Thank you.